Assalamu alaikum. And dear brothers, will you all please come forward and fill the gaps? The Quran Tilawat by Muhammad Mubeddin Mia, and after that another Rasul by Muhammad Mansur Alam. After this we'll have the guest speaker speaking, Sheikh Saad al-Attas from Syria, and he's sitting in front of you, and he's a qualified Sheikh from Syria, Damascus, and he's being taught by the best scholars in Syria. This speech will be delivered in English, and the title is How We Have Lost the Traditional Way of Islam. After this speech, the end speech will be given by Muhammad Hafiz Halaluddin. This is our teacher there. And he will be giving the speech, a short speech on our classes on fiqh, which we are starting on Tuesday evenings. After this, the prizes will be given for a competition for children, and this will be presented by Sheikh Saad al-Attas. And after Asr prayer, after question and answer session, there will be an Asr prayer, and after Asr prayer, there will be food served. So please everyone stay for the food, you know, and take part in the blessings. And throughout the day there will be cassettes and books, Islamic books available for sale. So if you do pop out, then please help yourself to buy them. Thank you very much. First of all, Quran Tilawat by Muhammad Muhyiddin Mia.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وإن تبدوا ما في أنفسكم أو تخفوه يحاسبكم به الله ويغفر لمن يشاء ويعذب من يشاء والله على كل شيء قدير آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفارق بين أحد من رسله قالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها لها ما كسبت وعليها ما اكتسبت ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملت على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا أنت وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين صدق الله العظيم.
Now I have the pleasure to introduce Muhammad Mansur Alam, who will be saying the Naat Rasul.
Sallallahu ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أنت شمس أنت بدر أنت نور فوق نوري أنت إكسير وغاني أنت مصباح السرور صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أشرق البدر علينا فاختفت منه البدور مثل حسنك ما رأينا قط يا وجه السرور صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم يا نبي يا محمد يا رسل خفيقين يا معيد يا مماجات يا إمام القبلتين صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى الله على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ذكر خير الورى بے خطر کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے ہاں یہی کام شاہ موسحر کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے اور چاہتے ہو جبر سے کرم کی گٹھا آپ کے گھر میں آئے حبیب خدا نعت سے روشنی اپنی گل کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے اور زندگی میں ہزاروں سفر کر لیے دل نے چاہا نہ چاہا مگر کر لیے اب درے مصطفیٰ کا سفر کیجئے اب درے مصطفیٰ کا سفر کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے اور لاکھ تو فاہلے کن کنارہ نہیں اب تو ناصر کا کوئی سہارا نہیں ایک نظر میرے آقا ادھر کیجئے ذکر خیر الورا بے خطر کیجئے سلام
MashaAllah, that was Mansur Alam and presenting Na'at Rasul. Now I have the honor to present Sheikh Sadr Abbas, our guest speaker, to start, and it will be from this time till 2 o'clock and until 4 o'clock, and then 4 till 4:30 there will be question and answer session. Papers and pens will be provided. Thank you.
Alhamdulillah. والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Brothers in Islam, respected ulama and maulanas Alhamdulillah, praise and thanks is due upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who creates all actions. وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, He has created you or He has created us in our actions. And indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the prime source or the primary source for us being here today. Alhamdulillah. And for this we need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not for only this act, but every good act which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on our limbs. Every praiseworthy act, we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates everything, including our actions. And then we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because there is no other There's none other but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that knows the true status of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we ask him Jalla Jalaluhu to place his richest and most earning blessings upon our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For truly there's no one else but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that knows the true status of this Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it incumbent upon mu'mineen, upon malaika, and upon himself to praise and bless this Prophet, saying in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. In this particular ayah, in my opinion, comprises the greatest status of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's no need to go into the detail of the ayah, perhaps on another occasion. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send upon this Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam his blessings with his endless speech that has no beginning and no end. Alhamdulillah, it's by time that we as a community, alhamdulillah, in Keithley, it's a small community yet very big and very concentrated with lots of Muslims, alhamdulillah. It is a great blessing to see that, or a great joy to see that Muslims do effort for the upliftment of themselves as far as the deen is concerned. And there's nothing else that is more praiseworthy in the eyes and more beautiful in the eyes or the holy sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than Muslims that wants to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially in our times today, where things has gone a little bit difficult, not only in the UK, I'm originally from South Africa. I spent 7 years in Damascus, and I spent 8 months in Kuwait. And I've seen some of Saudi Arabia, and the picture basically looks the same everywhere. Islam is being watered down. Islam is being watered down. And it's upon us and nobody else. No malak will be sent. It's upon us to do that extra effort. It's upon us to revive Islam and upon nobody else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not change the people until the people do effort themselves. But you also need to realize that in the times that we are living today, it's a very difficult time. Our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said so in a hadith. He said, يأتي زمان يكون القابض على دينه كالقابض على الجمرة. There will come a time when a person who wants to stand steadfast on his deen will be like a person who holds on to a piece of coal, hot coal. Imagine how painful it might be to hold on to a hot coal. In our times today, in order for a young man at a school to hold tight to his Islamic principles and to his identity is not an easy thing. It's not an easy thing. Our children, they go to school, they leave the house as mu'mineen, and Allah Ta'ala a'lam what will happen when they enter the gates of the schoolyard with all the different secular ideas that are being pumped and forced down there. Islamic hearts, what will happen to the identity? The fear is upon us as elders, as parents, that what will happen to the generation that will follow? What type of generation will they be? And truly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged all people to protect ourselves and our family from the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. Protect yourselves and your family from the hellfire. Protect yourselves and your family from the hellfire. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, كلكم مسؤول كلكم راعي وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته جزاك الله خيرا. Everybody is a راعي. He is a shepherd. And each shepherd will be held accountable for his responsibility. And who is his responsibility? Those children of future generation. And gatherings like this reminds me of a beautiful hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said alayhi salatu wa salam in a hadith sahih. He said مثل قائم على حدود الله والواقع فيها. He says the like of a person who is transgressing the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the person who is not transgressing the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like that of a people who boarded a ship. And then on the ship, people were divided. Some got the upper part of the ship and some people got the whole of the ship. The people at the bottom, they found it difficult to get water, fresh water from above. They always had to pass the people on top and disturb them to get fresh water. And one of them decided, why shouldn't we just drill a hole in the ship and get the water straight from the source? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uses this mathal, this example. He says, if they were to continue or were left alone to do that what they were busy doing, then they would have been destroyed and everybody in the ship would have been destroyed. And if they were stopped by one person or by a few, and then they would have been saved, and everybody on the ship would have been saved. And this is exactly what our communities, not only here, and repeating this, not only here in the UK, or more specifically in Keithley, but right around the world. If there's not a few people that stand up to do the effort to help one another, to remind one another about this deen, then this deen is not going to progress. And our deen is a progressive religion. It's not stagnant. It's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages all mu'min, فَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind one another, because the reminder only is a benefit to a mu'min. We tend to forget, we are human, and so on. And we have to look at history as well, because this is not the only time when this took place. We are forgetful about certain of our principles. This is not the first time it happened. It's a regurgitating phenomenon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the Muslimin in each time with a test. And the test is there to see, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. How does the ayah go? تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala test you to see who of you are the best indeed. So each ummah will get a test, or each generation will get a test. It's just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sunnah. It's just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way to test his ibad. So in our time, we've got a test at hand. And are we going to pass this test? Yes or no? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the previous mu'mineen just after the fall or the change of the third century, the century in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala foretold will be the end of the centuries of barakah, of blessings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested the mu'mineen on the aqidah, on the belief. And the government was a Mu'tazili government, a government that held the belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his divine speech is created, like we are created. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine speech is not created. It's not a created thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlike us. And there's other denominations that came up with all sorts of misguiding ideas, and Islam had to be protected. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time rose from amongst his righteous slaves, people like Abu Hassan al-Ash'ari and Abu Mansur al-Maturidi, scholars that stood the test of the punishment of the Mu'tazilis and brought the Aqeed of Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah to life, and it continued until we received it. At a time, not only the Aqeedah was tested of the Mu'mineen, but at a time, the Hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was fabricated to a very, very large degree. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the ulama, scholars, to learn the study of Hadith methodology, and memorize the Hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to such a degree whereby they can differentiate what is fabricated and what is not. And the Quran was fabricated by the heretics. Yet the ulama, once again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the ulama people to save the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, is the source of all survivals that this deen experienced. We have sent down this dhikr, this Quran, and we will protect it. In our time today, our enemy got a bit clever. They realized that there's no other way, because they've tried everything, even to annihilate the Muslim Ummah. You know, at the time that the Mongols invaded Iraq, it was one of the catastrophes that Islam will never, that the world will never forget. Something similar happened in Palestine when the Crusaders ended Palestine and slaughtered our brothers and sisters to such a degree where the horses walked knee deep into the blood of our brethren. This happened. And even though they recognize this is one of the black spots on the history of Christendom, but we always forgive one another for the mistakes we've done. So they've tried everything to take this deen from the face of the planet, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is behind this deen. We should never forget that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is behind this deen. Today, they discovered that every human has a nafs. He's got a self. And this self is easily distracted from its course. We need to entice it. And to entice this nafs is what will give us victory over this deen. And this is exactly what our enemies are trying today, is to entice our nafs, to beautify this dunya, to make this dunya full of leisure and pleasure and splendor, so that our nufus can't leave and can't detach ourselves from what we are tasting. It is a difficult process because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested us with his nafs. Inna nafsa la'ammaratun bisu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that the nafs is that particular thing which we have placed not only in Muslims but in all humans. What is the quality and what's the attribute of this nafs? It is the ammaratun bisu, not the amira, but the ammara. And ammara is a word based on a corroborative scale in Arabic, if you know Arabic. This scale, ammara on fa'ala, is a corroborative scale. It's not only ordering us once in a while to do bad, but it orders us in every moment of our life with bad. This is the nafs. So we've got to fight this nafs. Yet around us is things that helps the nafs. The dunya is beautified around us. And the nafs calls out to these things. Why don't we taste that? Why don't we taste that? Why don't we try this out? This is something which our nafs continuously are enticing us with, to go ahead and taste the pleasure and the niceness of this dunya. But we forgot what this dunya is worth. We forgot. And a mu'min is a person that sees things in its true reality. This is a mu'min. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to take us out of the state of delusion into the state of certainty. To know exactly what we have here and why we're here in this dunya and where we're going to. This dunya, let me just give you an example of what this dunya is worth. A great alim by the name of Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah, he enters upon the ruler of a third of the civilized world at that time, Harun Rashid. He was one of the rulers of the Umayyad dynasty, Harun Rashid. And he comes upon this ruler, he's a ruler of a third of the civilized world at that time. He comes upon him, he says, As-salamu alayka ya ayyuha Zahid. He said, peace upon you, O Zahid. And what is Zahid? Zahid is somebody who's contented himself with very little. Somebody who's a minimalist. And upon this, Harun Rashid gets a shock. He says, you calling me a Zahid? He says, well, you have settled with what is less than that of a mosquito. You have settled for that that is less worth the letter of a mosquito. So he said, explain. He said, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, لو كان الدنيا تزن عند الله جناح بعوضة لما سقى الكافر منها جرعة ماء. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if this dunya had to weigh the weight of a mosquito, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have given a kafir one sip of water. This is what this dunya is worth. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very, very specific in the choosing of his words. He said, lo, if this dunya had to weigh. If this dunya had to weigh the weight of a mosquito. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have given the kuffar one sip of water. But if you look around us, we see that they're having a joyous time. They have much more than only a sip of water. That is an indication that this dunya doesn't even weigh a mosquito. Now, let's say for example, hypothetically speaking, that this dunya weighs a mosquito. This dunya weighs a mosquito. Right? Hypothetically speaking, it weighs a mosquito. We say, well, if the dunya weighs a mosquito, we divide the dunya into thirds, three thirds. One third, second, and the third. Third. One third or two thirds, we remove already from it. Because two thirds of the dunya, if I'm speaking correctly, is water. We left with a third. Cut off two thirds from your mosquito wing. Cut off two thirds from your mosquito wing, and set with one third. And then we say, we take that third, and we look at how many countries is in this dunya. Approximately 180 countries in this dunya. We take that third and we divide it into 180 parts. We divide it into 180 parts. And then, of course, we have to look in amongst the smallest parts for Britain because it's a very small dot on the dunya. Once we get that part, we divide it into all the areas in Britain. And then we finally come to Keithley. And that if we can see the part in our hand or with the help of a microscope, we have to dissect that part into all the streets and come to my little house or to my factory in which I sit behind the desk and I think I'm somebody. I think I'm somebody. Or I've got all this amount of money in my bank and I'm thinking I'm somebody. The student think he knows it all. You think you're somebody.
You've got nothing
except that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you. Now, so the next time a mosquito sits on your arm, don't eat it, but look at it and try to look at the mosquito wing and try to dissect it into its different fragments the way we dissect it today. The summer's coming up, I hope the summer mosquitoes will come. Al-Muhim, this is the haqiqah of dunya. And this is how a mu'min should travel through this dunya. This is how a mu'min should travel through this dunya. One of our main purposes is of gathering here is to make us realize as well why is it that we have been inflicted with so much trials and tribulations. It's natural for a mu'min when he's in a difficulty to make dua, and we are making dua. But what has happened with our du'as? It has been left unanswered. We make dua, but there comes nothing from it. We can understand this in two ways. The first way, and that is what I hope it is not, and that is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, "Inna Allah tayyibun." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tayyib, is pure. La yaqbalu illa tayyiba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept that which is pure. In the hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions a man. فَذَكَرَ رَجُلًا يُطِيرُ السَّفَرَ. A man who takes a very lengthy journey. يُطِيرُ السَّفَرَ. The ulama say it's either for jihad or it's either for hajj or to visit a relative. Let's say it's for hajj. يُطِيرُ السَّفَرَ. And when he gets to Mecca, and of course, Al-Hajj Arafah. Arafah, if you stay in Arafah and you did that, you've got your Hajj. This is the main integral or the main rukn of a Hajj. The man finds himself in Hajj and he raises his hands up in the sky and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Ya Rab. Oh Allah, I need this and I need that and I want this and I want that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, or the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the same person who asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of these things, in his stomach is haram. What is on his back is haram. What he wears at his house is haram. فَأَمَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لِذَلِكَ. How can we answer a person like that? So this is the first thing. And if you look today in our world, in the way we live, most of the things that we consume, do we ask ourselves the question, is this halal? Is it mashbur? Mashbur meaning, I mean, most of us know what the meaning of mashbur is. Is there a shubha in it? Is there a doubt in it? Halal or not halal? Are we caught up into the two? What do we do? Do we go, ma'alaysh, you know, we just take it, you know, inshallah, perhaps it will be halal. And this is the wrong move to do. What about our loans that we do? What about consuming riba? What about consuming riba? And this is something which will derive at the end of time as well. It doesn't make sense. A person asking another person for a loan of 100,000 and then he has to return twice the amount of money back, or sometimes thrice. Doesn't make sense. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has outrightly declared war against any person that consumes riba. Not only him, the one who gives, the one who takes, the one who signs the paper, the one who works with riba in all spheres. The ulama said even a person who works in a bank, it's haram to eat at his house because he works with riba. Subhanallah. So, and it's difficult to confine this, or it's unfair to confine this only with without banks. But all major companies,
deals with riba,
they have to insure everything. And we are working with riba irrespective if we like it or not sometimes. Unless the person, like the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has explained the hadith, has to find himself between two mountains in order to safeguard himself from this big yani enormity, which is riba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares war against the person who consumes riba. And there's only two things in this deen to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares war. One, the first one is harming the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speaking bad about them. And the other one is riba. And we know already what the answer is or the outcome is of the whole. So this is one of the reasons which I feel, which I hope is not the reason why our du'as is not answered. Because Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas once, Ya Rasulullah, udu'uli hatta akuna mustajaba du'a. He asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, my du'a, so that I can become mustajaba du'a, so that my du'as can be accepted at all times. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Sa'd, atib mat'amak, takun mustajaba du'a. What does it mean? Purify your source of food, what you place in your belly, and then you will become mustajab al-dua. You will become mustajab al-dua. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam once walked past a man asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rab, Ya Allah, Ya Jabbar, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for quite a long time. And they say that Musa stood and wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the dua of this person. And then he couldn't take it anymore. He said, Ya Rab, because he was Kaleemullah, he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Ya Rab, when are you going to answer your slave? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon Sayyidina Musa saying, Ya Musa, even if this person had to cry or cries until his ruh leaves his body, asking and crying at the same time, I will never answer him. Sayyidina Musa upon this asked, Ya Allah, walimada, walimadalik, and why is that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, because what he has in his stomach is haram, and what he has in his back is haram, his clothes, and what he has in his house is haram. So this is a very, very important aspect for the mu'min in our lives, and our enemies are well aware of this factor. This is one of the ways we can demolish Islam. Because if the dua is one of the most powerful tools that they have, if this is not working, if this part of this dynamic structure of Islam doesn't work, we have achieved a great deal in our goal. So the other reason which we hope is the reason why our du'as is not answered. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Udu'uni astajib lakum, answer me and I will ask me and I will answer you, call upon me and I will answer you. But also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. إِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي, if they ask you about me, say unto them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, I'm close, أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ, I will answer the call or the prayer of the caller, but on condition, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُ لِي, let them answer my call, وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي, and that they believe in me. So there is a condition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the second reason which we hope it is, coming back to that, is that we hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps behind the answer for the simple fact, and that is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer in a time when He wills, and not in a time when we will, when we want to expect an answer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one the Ullah and the Ulama has indicated to this. One of the jahl of the sa'il, the ignorance of the sa'il, the person who asks or make dua, is that sometimes he expects a ijaba immediately. He expects an answer from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preventing you from the answer at a particular moment is rahmah upon you. Is rahmah upon you and not in favor for you. Asa an tuhibbu shay'an wa huwa sharrun lakum. Asa an takrahu shay'an wa huwa khayrun lakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, perhaps you dislike something and it is good for you. Wa asa an tuhibbu shay'an wa huwa sharrun lakum. And perhaps you love something and it is not good for you. Wallahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows and you know not. Who sees the future? Who sees the future? And like some of our ulama by the name of Shaykh Nuha bin Kala, he said perhaps if the Muslims just look around them and find themselves in this difficult state, they should implement in their lives what the Prophet and the Sahabas implemented in their lives when they were in Makkah at the time. They were the minority, they were weak, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept on telling them, don't lift up arms, don't fight. If they had to, and the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was only until after the hijrah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the mu'mineen to do jihad. Before that, no. It was more of a tarbiyah, a lesson to uplift their souls and their states, to become more better mu'min, to persevere. And this is a very high state, to persevere and submit ourselves for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul wishes for us, to submit, because this state is called the abad. So Allah, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wish was to bring the Sahaba up to the standard of ubudiyya, of true worshippers. And when the time of jihad comes, they won't say, la, we refrain because it's a very tough thing. But they were ready for that. At the moment, we are in the stage that we're not ready for jihad. And jihad is but only a call to Islam. And not like people do jihad today, like we see on the television and hear about jihad. Jihad is a call to Islam. Because Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, a person jumped on his horse and he said, Ya Rasulullah, and he grabbed his sword. He said, Ya Rasulullah, what is the best of jihad? And to his surprise, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Afdalu jihadin kalimatu haqqin inna sultan al-ja'ir. Is to say a word of truth in front of an unjust ruler. Not to what some people think it is all about. So this alim by the name of Shaykh Muhammad Kala says, we are in that state, the Makkian period. We are the minority, we don't have any government. We have to submit. Work on ourselves. Let us brush up. It's actually a mercy for us at this particular point to be in the state. To be in the state. To look at ourselves, to brush up, to rectify what is wrong. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide us, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sunnah is of such that when a person wants to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he come closer to Him twice as fast. وإن تقرب إلي ماشيا, if he comes closer to me walking, تقربت إليه هرولة, I come to him running. And this is what we need to internalize and get into our lives, to do that little step, that little step. There's a beautiful happening that took place in around about the 200 years after Hijrah, or more. An alim by the name of Ibrahim ibn Adham radiallahu ta'ala anhu, perhaps all of us might know him or heard about him. Ibrahim ibn Adham, he's a student or he's a teacher of Sufyan al-Thawri, which we spoke about earlier on. Ibrahim ibn Adham came upon a people, and they all knew him as a salih man, and they asked him a question. A question all of us ask ourselves today. Exact same. That is why I say the situation we found ourselves is a bit different to what happened before, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will undoubtedly inevitably test, we will inevitably be tested as generations go on and on and on. It's a regurgitating thing. Allah subhanahu will test us. They were also tested with a similar thing, and that is their du'as were not answered. When was this? That's why I said about in between 300 and 200 Hijri, years after Hijrah, say about 1,000 plus years ago. The people came to him, he was opening the souq, and said, Ya Abul Qasim, why is it that our du'as is not accepted? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Udu'uni astajib lakum, I will call unto me and I will answer, your prayer, your call. He kept silent and he said, the reason for this state is because our heart died with 10 things. What are these 10 things? He said the first one is, you claim or you know your Allah, or you say you know your Allah, yet you do not obey Him. That's the first one. It's not too far from our times. Person can read history, you'll get a shock of your life. Don't think that this is the first time that Islam was in this particular state. Read the lifetime of Shaykh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, 500 years after Hijrah. 500 years after Hijrah, Islam was in a similar state. Dunya kept in the heart, creeped in the hearts of the mu'mineen, and it weighed higher than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine sharia. Same thing happened. So yeah, we're repeating these words of Ibrahim ibn Adham hundreds of years after his demise, and it still applies to us today. What did he say first of all is, he said, you know Allah or you claim to know Allah, yet you disobey Him. What type of knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is this, then you ask the question. What Ibrahim ibn Adam actually said, or is actually trying to say, is that we claim to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, yet we don't. Yet we don't. A poet said in a beautiful poetry, perhaps this will bring us to a better understanding of his words radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The poet says, تَعْصِلْ إِلَهَا وَأَنْتَ تَظْهَرُ حُبَّهُ هذا لعمري في القياس بديع لو كان حبك صادقا لأطعته إن المحب لمن يحب مطيع. The verses read, or the translation of the verses is, we claim, he says, تعصي الإله, you disobey your إله, your creator, وأنت تظهر حبه, you disobey him in your heart, your niya is, there's no niya. need to do the action. Your action is not based on a niyyah. That means your action doesn't have any direction. Your action doesn't have any direction. It's like a person who comes to the king. He says, "Oh king, here is a slave, a servant is a hadiyah, and the servant is a dead corpse. What will the king do?" Many of us has this. We do actions, but there's no hudur, there's no presence of heart, there's no ikhlas, there's no sincerity in there. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that. Because it's so vital for a mu'min to have this aspect, and it is ikhlas in his a'mal. Don't worry about immersed, getting immersed in your ibadah. Don't worry about ladha, about sweetness of ibadah. This will come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order it to come. The only aspect we need to worry about is our niyyah, our ikhlas in our actions. So here he says under this person, ta'asil ilaha wa anta tadharu hubbahu. You are doing all these good acts, but inside you are impure. Or the person, he does good actions, but he does it for the sight of people, for riya. I do it for my mother, I do it for my ustad, I do it for the community to see that I'm following the right path. He says, هذا لعمري في القياس بديع. The poet becomes sarcastic. He says, He says, by my life, this is a very splendor, a very astonishing way of making an illogical deduction. Like saying, a fruit is a vegetable. Doesn't make sense. It's not the right type of analogical deduction. So he says, لو كان حبك, if your hope, if your love had to be صادق, sincere, he says, لأطعته, then he would have obeyed him. إن المحب, the one who loves, or the lover, لمن يحب, unto the one he loves, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مطيع, he's obedient. Not only that, he says, you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You claim to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which we need to understand. It's one of the principal things that a mu'min has to have in his heart, is the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the key principles. A mu'min, or the focal points each mu'min has to look out for when you reach the age of puberty. Yes, know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what do we mean by knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or what constitutes knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ulama of aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they say, knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not merely bearing the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's unity in that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to bear this concept in your mind as far as the hard drive and that is it. No. This is not what the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah calls iman. This is not iman. This is not ma'rifah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if that had to be so, then all the kuffar who believe so would have been mu'mini. How many people do we know that knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He knows. It's up here. It's in his brain. It's in his intellect. And he knows that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a true mu'min. How many people, how many orientalists submitted to this? But they had not said the shahada. The true way, the way it ought to be said. And what do we mean by this is that the true iman or true ma'rifah is not as far as the intellect, because this intellect is but only the tool which is guided by the heart, or by the sir, or by the ruh, or by the nafs. Because these words, qalb, sir, the secret, the ruh, the spirit, the nafs, all these words in Islam or in aqidah or in tasawuf is used interchangeably. They all mean the same. So if we say that the person has it in his intellect, that is not what we mean. That is not what we want. We want the person to internalize the concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's unity in his heart. Because this heart, this is the controller of the intellect. Whether the intellect will say right or wrong, or true or false, or bad or evil, that intellect is guided by the seer. Should we really say this? The ulama don't suck this out of the Psalms. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the heart, to the intellect. Where is the place of the intellect, the true intellect? It's in the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَهُمْ قُلُوبُ لَا يَفْقَوْنَ بِهَا. Or in another ayah, لَهُمْ أو don't they have hearts by which they think or ponder, يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers the act of intellect, of thinking, of pondering, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَقْفَالُهَا. Don't even ponder about the Qur'an, or is it upon the brains or uqul? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't use uqul, but He used hearts. Is it on their hearts, shackles that prevent them from pondering upon the Qur'an? So iman is something we need to internalize, a concept of the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine principles is something we need to internalize. Because once that is internalized in our bloodstream, in our ruh, in our flesh, this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inspire us. This is the first step. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come closer to the ibad. And this is why the Salafus Salihin, they said, لا تستضئ الإجابة وقد سددت طرقها بالمعاصي. If previously said a person who knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a person that disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he does, immediately tawbah comes up. Immediately. So the Salaf al-Salihin said, they say, لا تستضئ الإجابة. Don't say, when is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gonna answer my prayer? I've been asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for years for a child, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not granted me. I've been to the Baytullah, I've done all the remedies. No answer, no child, or no victory upon my struggles, no success in my endeavors. When is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to answer it? The ulama say, don't say that. وَقَدْ سَدَّدْتَ طُرُقَهَا بِالْمَعَاصِ. And you have blocked the ijaba, the answer, from coming to you with your ma'asi, with your sins. And this is what Ibrahim ibn Adam is trying to tell us. You know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you claim to know Him, but you're doing ma'asi. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevent from us the answer. Now, some poet said, نَحْنُ نَدْعُ إِلَهِ فِي كُلِّ كَرْبٍ ثُمَّ نَنْسَاهُ وَعِنْدَ كَشْفِ الْكُرُوبِ كَيْفَ نَرْجُ الْإِسْتِجَابَةَ لِلدُّعَاءِ وَقَدْ سَدَّدْنَا طُرُقَ بِالْدُّنُوبِ. Beautiful two lines of poetry. He says, this نَحْنُ نَدْعُ, we call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night, فِي كُلِّ كَرْبٍ, in all of the difficulties that we are going and facing in this dunya, which we are going through. ثُمَّ نَنْسَاهُ عَيْنَ كَشْفِ الْكُرُوبِ. And when the difficulties pass, we forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كَيْفَ نَرْجُ. How is it possible for a person to expect إِجَابَةَ الدُّعَاء, a dua to be answered, وَقَدْ سَدَّدْنَا طُرُقَهَا بِالْمَعَاصِ أَوْ بِالْذُنُوبِ. And we have blocked the passage of the answer with al-dhunub. So this is the first point that Ibrahim ibn Adham radiallahu ta'ala anhu tries to make us realize. why our du'as is not being answered. Secondly, he says, you recite the Quran, yet you do not act according to the Quran. You recite the Quran, yet you do not act according to the Quran. In the Quran, ulama say, this 500 or plus verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs, outrightly instructs the mu'mineen, do this and do that. Some ulama say, no, there is only 180 ayat. And this goes back to whether we want to consider the qisas, or the stories in the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way of instructing us to do certain things, because within the stories of the Quran, there is laws, there is adab, there is certain mannerism that we need to follow. Characters in these stories to follow. But before we get to all these instructions, we need to ask the question first, do we recite the Quran? Do we recite the Quran? Do we make time for the Quran, or do we listen to the Quran as the only nuts? I'm struggling with some kids at our local Abu Zahra, but I'm always optimistic with me teaching them, because they've got very high ambition. They can never say that they are full, or it's in them not to say that they are full. They always want more and more and more. So I tell them, and when you read the Quran, don't read it to a barakah, but read it to understand the Quran. Read it to understand the Quran. So we ask the question first, do we recite the Quran? If we recite the Quran, what type of reciter are we? What type of reciter are we of the Quran? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, and perhaps this hadith will help us to make us understand where do we fit in as far as our relationship with the Quran is concerned. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith related by Imam Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Muhammad Abu Musa al-Ash'ari was one of the Sahabas that has been given Mizmarun min Mazamiri al-Dawood, Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam. Like our Imam, mashallah, it's got a splendor, a beautiful, beautiful voice, mashallah. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to refer to these beautiful voices as a Mizmarun Mazamiri, Mizmar min Mazamir Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam. The tunes are the tunes of Sayyidina Dawood, because Sayyidina Dawood was granted the ability to recite the Zabur in such a beautiful tone that the Jibal used to dance with his tune. And the Tumur, the birds in the sky, used to stop in the sky and listen to the tunes the way Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam used to recite. On the tunes Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam used to recite the Zabur. Sayyidina Abu Musa al-Ash'ari was one of these people that recited the Quran with such beautiful tunes. He says, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ الَّذِي يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنِ مَثَلُ الْأُتْرُجَّةِ وَكَمَثَلِ الْأُتْرُجَّةِ. The mu'min that recites the Quran, he is like that of a utruja. Listen carefully. A mu'min, a person who believes, recites the Quran. And when he recites the Quran, he internalizes, he embodies what the Quran teaches, and he internalizes the messages of the Quran. What is he like? He's like a utruja. Utruja is a fruit, we call it a very known fruit, it's called the orange. You smell the orange, it smells nice. And when you eat the orange, it tastes nice. This is what a mu'min is that recites the Quran. He smells nice, it's nice to be in his company, and it tastes nice. Whatever he says, it's beautiful words. His company is a blessing. Being with him, you feel the feeling of tranquility. This is one adab that everybody that studies the Quran, this is one adab, main adab that we need to focus on. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَمَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ الَّذِي لَا يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ, and like a mu'min that doesn't recite the Quran, كَمَثَلِ التَّمْرَى, is like a date. So there are mu'mineen that recite the Quran, they are like oranges. So are we oranges or are we dates? Are we a mu'min that does not recite the Quran? Because a date, it tastes nice, but it doesn't have a smell. You can't smell it, you can't detect the good company immediately. But the person that recites the Quran, a mu'min who recites the Quran, immediately your ruh says, it wants to go out to that person. You want to be with him. It's a pleasure to be with him. A person, a mu'min that doesn't recite the Quran, his company is dry. You go out and say, what did I benefit from this person? He spoke good, but nothing actually penetrated. So there is a type of knockers there. Then Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues, he says, now we move on from a mu'min to a munafiq. وَمَثَلَ الْمُنَافِقُ الَّذِي يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنِ, like the munafiq, the hypocrite, that recites the Quran, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كَمَثَلِ الرَّيْحَانَ, it's like a rehana. And a rehana is a flower that has a beautiful smell, but if you taste it, it's one of the most bitterest tastes that you ever tasted before. So a munafiq recites the Quran, mashallah, is attractive, he attracts people. But when you intermingle with him, when you move with him, when you accompany him, you say, no, this is not my company. Even though he recites the Quran. And how many of this sort of people do we find? He's not my company. He recites beautiful, but he does it either for the sake of man, but not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the munafiq that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And then finally the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَثَلُ الْمُنَافِقِ أَلَّذِي لَا يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنِ, and then the munafiq that does not recite the Quran, the hypocrite that does not recite the Quran, is like a hambala, and a hambala is a fruit that doesn't have any smell, and when you taste it, it is, you know, the pinnacle of bitterness when it comes to fruits. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us from this and protect us from this state. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah subhanahu wa Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith related by Umar ibn Khattab, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise people through this book, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put people down through this book, and may we not be all those people which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to put down through this book. Allahumma rizukna tilawataha ana al-layli wa atrafa al-nar. Oh Allah, grant us its recitation during the day and during the night. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, and this is one of the things we need to always carry with us, because the Quran is considered to be the best dhikr a person can make. The one reason is this hadith. Man qara'a al-Quran, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says in a hadith related from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man qara'a harfan min kitabillah, whosoever reads one harf from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, falahu hasana, you will get one hasana. One hasana. Wal hasanatu bi ashri amthaliha. And one hasana is equivalent to 10 rewards. To 10 rewards. This is one harf. And he explains this. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains and makes it clear to the Sahaba and to his ummah that follows. This is La aqulu alif la mim. There's three letters in there. Is one harf. However, I mean, alif is a harf, lam is a harf, and mim is a harf. If somebody had to recite only Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim or Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, how many rewards is this? One page, how many? It sometimes, it can be uncountable. It can be uncountable. This is why the Quran is the best form of dhikr. The best form of dhikr. And the Quran is much more great benefits than this. Instead of just reading the Quran, qira'a barakah, internalize its teachings and carry out what the Quran teaches us. Even though it's so small, but even though it's small, it will count to our benefit the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Nawas ibn Sam'an, a Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, said, he said, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yu'ta Yawm al-Qiyamah bil Quran wa ahlihi. The day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Quran will be brought and the people of the Quran will be brought. The people of the Quran, very important to know, who are the people of the Quran? The people that recited the book and practiced its teachings. This is the Quran. وَكَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ بِهِ. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is explicit here. He says, they used to carry out the teachings of the Quran. في الدنيا. تقدمه سورة البقرة وآل عمران تحاجاني عن صاحبهما. رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم says the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, these people, the Ahlul Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran, they will walk in front of this person protecting him, or they will intercede for him. And Allah Ta'ala alam what shape and form Surah Al-Baqarah and Surah Ali Imran will be in. Allah Ta'ala alam bidalik. He alone is knowledgeable of that. Like Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, after the people of Jahannam is in Jahannam, the people of Jannah is in Jannah, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will slaughter death. How does death look? Allah Ta'ala alam. Some riwayah says it's like a sheep, a kabush, half of it is white and half of it is black. Allah Ta'ala alam exactly with these type of things. But this is what the reward will be of the person that carried out the Quran. And may Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala make us of these people, because this is one of the reasons why our dua doesn't go up or the answer doesn't come down. Ulama say it's like a person who has been ordered by a king to build a bridge. To build a bridge. And the king ordered for the plans to be brought to him. He's the best engineer. He's the best engineer in the country. Get all the plans to him. And the king left him with the plans and with all the men and all the equipment to complete the structure of the bridge. 1,000 days went by, and he read the plan over and over for 1,000 times. Every day he would read the plan through. And to such a degree he memorized the plan. If that king will find out what he is up to, what do you think he will do with him? The same with the Quran. This is our plan to get to the Akhirah, and if we not utilize this and we don't put in action what this plan is instructing us to do, we can't expect the King of Kings to be satisfied with us. And this is just an example to get us an understanding of Ibrahim ibn Adam's words when he said, we read the Quran but we don't follow its teachings. And this is why the dua has been refused, the answer has been kept behind. He says, you know Shaytan, yet you have agreed with him. And this is the third reason why he says, you know Shaytan, you know who he is. And who is Shaytan? Shaytan is that cursed character which Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala threw out of paradise. Only? No. It's not only that character that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw out of paradise because of his arrogance and because he tried to reason. No. He is that character which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed there to misguide each one of us. And he will never settle for anything less until we are misguided. Until we are misguided. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dismissed him out of the Jannah, he said, فَبِمَا أَغْوَيْتَنِي. Because of your refusal or your abandoning me from the Jannah, he referred his sin that he did, and which was he was not obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command when he was ordered to bow down to Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misguided him. He said, now I will mislead everybody that believes in me. لَأَقْوَدَنَّا. I will sit in the path, in front of them, at the back, behind of them, on the right and on the left. I will wait for them and I will misguide them. Shaitan is serious when he said this. He was not making a joke. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, what does it mean? He will wait for us in front of us. He will bring doubt in us as far as the akhirat is concerned. At the back of us, he will entice us with the dunya. Who gives this interpretation? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, tarjuman al-Quran. The person, the sahabi, with Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the dua for. Allahumma faqihu fi al-deen wa allimhu ta'wil. Oh Allah, grant him knowledge of the deen and learn, teach him the exegesis of this Quran. And he said, what does it mean when Shaitan said, I will sit on the right hand side of him? I will make him doubt in his deen. In his deen. On the left hand side, I will call him to ma'asi. I will call him to ma'asi. Now how do we understand this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this clear in an ayah. But before we quote the ayah, I want to give you an overall picture how Shaitan operates. Shaitan relies upon one very important aspect, and that is our eyesight. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, An-nadhru, the eyesight or the gazes of the mu'min, is a sahmun masmumun min siham iblis. It is one of Iblis's poisonous arrow. He relies upon the eyesight of man. The person who walks on the road, he sees all sorts of enticements around him. If he had to lower his gaze, he would have been freed from that. But we like to look around because we are attracted to many things. There's many things that attracts our attention. And the eyesight, when it falls on a beautiful lady, this is the point where Shaitan's whispering comes in. How beautiful is she? How beautiful. And then at the moment, the ulama explain this. They say, Nadratun, Nadratun, Fabtisamatun. You see the beautiful lady, and then there's a smile. Fabtisamatun. Fa kalamun, and then there is talking going on. Fa mawaidun, and then there's an appointment arranged. Fa liqa'un, and then there's a meeting. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us and says, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوًا مُبِينًا. Don't follow the steps of Shaitan. One, he sees her, he smiles. Second step, in this kalam, in this conversing with one another. And then there is a mawaid, an appointment is arranged between the two of them, and then there's a liqa. And Allah Ta'ala knows who is the third party overgathering in which there is two foreigners to one another. Shaitan. Now, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indicates to this khutuwat, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا. Don't follow the khutuwat. Khutuwat means steps. Don't follow the khutuwat of shaitan. إِنَّهُ كَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوًا مُبِينًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran as well, إِنَّ شَيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوًا. Shaitan is an enemy unto you. فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. He's an enemy unto you, so take him as an enemy. You have to use him as an enemy. And an enemy, what's an enemy? Is the enemy somebody you shake hands with? Somebody you share your intimate plans with? Is an enemy somebody you would like to accompany? Or is that somebody you want to get out of your way? He's an obstacle in your life. It's an obstacle in your life. This is how our attitude is supposed to be with shaitan. And the ulama say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed him there for a very, very great wisdom. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in the Quran, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. The plans of shaitan was but only weak. Sometimes it can be difficult upon man, upon the mu'min, to overcome his shaitan and to win his shaitan. But the ayah refers to the mu'min who relies upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is when the plans and the plots of shaitan becomes weak. We always say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. The common words, we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the curse of shaitan. That exactly tells us why it becomes easy for us to overtop shaitan, because we rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we had to rely upon our own efforts, I want to get rid of the TV. I'm going to put it in the children's room, and I'm going to take it out of the living room. I'm not going to see it. The children can enjoy their programs. Is this a smart move? No, it's not. Shaitan will come and will guide you back to that particular ma'asiyah. The only way you can get rid of it, if you cut it out completely, destroy it, get it out of the life. This is the only way. It will always come back to you. So, a person has to realize it becomes so difficult sometimes, there's no other way but to overtop shaitan through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when we enter the toilet, what do we say? The young kids, they should know this. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuthi wal-khaba'ithi wa min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Oh Allah, what do we do? We seek refuge in you. We don't go in there and say, where's the khubuth and the khaba'ith? I will take care of them. No. We say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no one we can rely upon except you against these evil demons in the hammam. Whenever we leave the house, what do we say? Bismillahi tawakkaltu ala Allahi wa'atasamtu billahi wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi. The shaitan will look at the other shaitan and say, Subhanallah. Not Subhanallah, but he will say, how do I have a chance against a person who has been protected, safeguarded and saved from our plans? This is what the shaitan says to the other shaitan in the hadith sahih. So what does the meaning, Bismillahi tawakkaltu ala Allah, in the name of Allah, I rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save me from shaitan. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna kayda shaitani kana ba'ifa, because his kayd is ba'if. Why? Because he rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the motto of mu'mineen. In all difficulties, in all spheres of difficulties, we rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And shaitan is, from this point of view, is a blessing for us. Why? Because when we find it difficult to overtopple him, we become true slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We come down to our knees and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us. When the nafs has got its hands all over us and spreads his disease of desires and shahawat and cardinal desires in our bloodstream. There's no one to rely or to save us from this shackles except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we become slaves, we become abid, we become worshippers. So the nafs, the shaitan, and the dunya is in fact a means of getting us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a rahmah. Ibrahim ibn Adam says, you know the shaitan, yet you have agreed with him. And this is one of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevents the answers from us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the curse of shaitan in all our endeavors in life. He fourthly says, you claim that you love the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet you've abandoned his sunnah. And this is a very touchy one. Why? This is a very touchy one. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the creation, is the greatest creation as far as taqwa, iman, nur, and all the spheres is concerned. He is the greatest creation, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Perhaps a way to explain this is the hadith of Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She said, once a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, ya Rasulullah, ana mushtaqun ilayk. I yearn to see you. During the day I'm at home, but my yearning becomes so much that I can't take it anymore. I have to leave my house and I have to come and see where you are and sit with you and be with you. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know what to say. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had no reply to this man, to the sahabi. He even referred and said, ya Rasulullah, my only fear is when you die, you will be raised with the Nabiyeen and the Siddiqeen, and you will be granted the highest place in Jannah. He says, as far as I'm concerned, and this is the greatest fear, he says, when I, as far as I'm concerned, I will enter the Jannah perhaps, and I don't know if I will see you in the Jannah. But his yearning is so much for the Rasul, so he wants to see him and he wants to be with him in the dunya and in the akhirah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know what to say to this person until Jibreel came and revealed an ayah, and the ayah reads, وَمَنْ يُطَعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ, whosoever obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul, فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. The one who obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger, those are the ones that will be granted the station with the Nabiyeen, with the Prophets, the Siddiqeen, the truthful slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa shuhada, the martyrs, wa salihin, in the righteous. Condition is ta'atullah wa ta'atul rasul, obedience to Allah and His Messenger. And of course, not in all spheres. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, fattaqullaha mastata'atum. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to your capacity. To your capacity, what you can do. Do what you can, and then from there onwards, wait on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's futuhat. But don't be relaxed and say, well, I'm not going to do any effort, and with this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide me. No, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I said it's a very touchy subject when it comes to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we neglect his sunnah. When we neglect his sunnah. And this is why we're also in a very confusing state. We claim to have the Prophet that is considered to be the Prophet of all the Prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the Ulul Azm in the Quran. There are five Prophets. from these five prophets, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the leader. These five Rusul, in other words. Who are they? From top of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Followed by Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. Followed by Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, Ruhullah. Followed by Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, Kalimullah. Sayyidina Ibrahim is Khalilullah. Our Prophet is Rasulullah. Lastly, Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salam. These prophets are called the Ulul Azam, because Azam means to literally means to be strict. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put them through very tough situations. These five prophets, who is the leader of them? Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He brought us a sunnah. And this sunnah is what we claim to be the way of life. But how far is many of us from the sunnah when it comes to internalization and embodiment of the sunnah? We say things, yet we're not doing them. And it's very touchy, I said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for two reasons we need to think very hard, is what our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be with us today of Yawm al-Qiyamah. If we did not do his sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, or carry out his sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kullukum tadkhuluna al-jannah. Everybody of you will enter Jannah, except the one who refuses. Except the one who refuses. The Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, who refuses to enter the Jannah? Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the one who obeys me, faqad dakhal al-jannah, he will enter Jannah. And the one who disobeys me, he is the one who refused. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those people who refuse to accept the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sunnah in our lives. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put us two major things. And perhaps because of these two major things, we need to respect him the way he ought to be respected. But read the Sahaba's history and see how they respected this Prophet and how they loved him. Sometimes we will laugh because it seems so silly. Because they went to such an extreme to love him. They drank his urine at the time. They drank his blood at the time. SubhanAllah. Out of love for this Prophet. But two things we need to bear in mind why we need to love him. And that is because he was sent as a mercy unto mankind. Not only mankind, but the alameen. Is a mercy to the alameen. The alameen is everything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was sent to jinn and ins, and he was sent to all objects. As for us, as far as us mu'mineen, he's a rahmah because he brought us the hidayah. And if it is not for the hidayah, what would our states be if they weren't hidayah from our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the akhirah? As far as the mushrikeen is concerned, he was even a rahmah for them. He was a rahmah unto the mushrikeen as well. He was a rahmah unto the mushrikeen as well. How do we interpret and understand this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّ مُعَذِّبِهِمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. And we were not to punish them for as long as you are amongst them. It's a rahmah upon the mushrikeen. Taif, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went through a difficult ordeal in Taif, Ya Latif. Sayyidina Aisha asked Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after one of the battles, have you experienced anything difficult, more difficult? It was Uhud, anything more difficult than this battle? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke to Sayyidina Aisha and he said, when I went to your people in Taif, this was more difficult on me. What happened there? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bled. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ras was exposed in such a way that he sent the Malakul Jibal to ask Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, it depends upon, it's solely dependent upon your wish. then I can close these two mountains upon these people. What was Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's reply? He said, no, this is not my wish. I was sent as a mercy, and perhaps out of his spines will come people that will say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So there's mercy unto the mushrikeen. In one of the battles of, I think it's the battle of Badr, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was injured, the blood flew, and he kept on wiping it. The Sahabi said, Ya Rasulullah, why are you wiping your cheeks? Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if my blood falls on this floor, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy our enemy. He said, Ya Rasulullah, let the blood fall on the floor, destroy them, let Allah destroy them. He said, no, I have not been sent as a destroyer or destructor, but I have been sent as a mercy to humanity. Isn't it him, not only humanity, but the alameen, includes everything. Isn't it him that taught us not to chop off a tree? It's a mercy, even the trees. Didn't he give us a hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam, about the person who gave water to a thirsty dog, and through that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ended in the Jannah? Isn't that hadith telling us to be good to animals? Once a woman entered the Jahannam because of a cat. The cat was tied and it died, she didn't feed the cat. Even doesn't the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indirectly telling us to be good to animals? So he was a rahmah to everything. To everything. And the other point why we need to really love this Prophet, the way he explained when he said the best form of iman, or no iman is complete until you love me more than what you love yourself, and not only that, but more than what you love your parents and your children. And Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not being conceited or anything. He was doing his prophetic duty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to order us that this is a wajib, we need to love him. He was doing his prophetic duty. The other point we need to love this Prophet sallallahu is because of the shafa'a. He will bring us a day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, where all the creation will run around and be in a stressful time. And they move from Sayyidina Adam, to Sayyidina Nuh, from Sayyidina Nuh to Sayyidina Ibrahim, and to all the Anbiya, to Sayyidina Isa, until Sayyidina Isa says, you have to go to Muhammad. There's no other way. And then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, yes, I'm the one that will take you out of this predicament. And this is the day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let the sun come down. Qadr meel, yani meel is a distance, which is the sun will come down to the edge of the creation. Qadr meel, it is a certain distance. Some ulama say a meel is a, because the word meel could also mean the kuhal that we use. When we dip the stick in the kuhal and put it on our eyes, that dipstick is a meal. The ulama said this is there's one of the opinions about that meal, the distance of the sun above the heads of creation. So severe the situation will be that the creation will say, oh Allah, get it over and done with. They will say, oh Allah, get it over and done with, even though it's to the hellfire. So severe the situation will be. People will drown in their sweat. Some people will stand knee deep in their sweat, navel deep, until the next, depending on the works they did. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go into prostration in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him, irfa' ra'asak, raise your head, sal tu'ta, ask and you will be given. Seek intercession and you will be granted intercession. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will say, none other but ummati, ummati, ummati. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go to the Jahannam and take up everybody who has got mithqal wa dharratin min iman. In his heart, mithqal wa dharra is a term used in Arabic, indicating to something very unspeakable, very small, very minute. Was got a very minute amount of iman in his heart, and those people were removed and placed in the Jannah through the shafa'ah. Then he will go alayhi salatu wasalam in another prostration the third time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, raise your head, ask, whatever you ask, you will be granted. Seek intercession, and intercession will be granted to you. And then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, well, it's not enough now for my ummah, I will ask myself, no. I will ask again, Ummati, Ummati, Ummati. It's all of us, we who believe in it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order that everybody who has mithqal khardal min iman, even a lesser portion of iman in the heart, take them out of the jahannam into the jannah. And then finally they said, third prostration will come. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will still mention his ummah. He says, Ya Allah, ummati, ummati, ummati. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order that the person who has aqal min khardal min iman in his heart, who has the very, very, very least amount of iman still in his heart, they take him out of the jahannam and place him in the jannah because of that prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this is something we need to address in our lives, otherwise the answers won't come. You are disobeying the beloved. The one who loves the beloved will obviously be sensitive over this issue. If his beloved is disobeyed, you are disobeying my beloved, so this is my attitude towards you. No answering of your du'as. You claim you love paradise, yet you do not act to gain it. And six, you proclaim your fear for Yahweh, yet you do not prevent yourself from sins. Something very few of us believe in today is the Akhirat. Jahannam, na Jannah wa Jahannam. Truly believe in it. Because we live in a secular state, these type of concepts are completely destroyed in the hearts of our young mu'min. This particular concept, Jama'atul Muslimin, is so important by Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for no other reason but because of its greatness and its importance. He mentioned this to be one of the arkan of iman. When Jibreel alayhi salam came upon the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Antu'minu billah." What is iman? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, "Antu'minu billah," to believe in Allah. Wa malaikati, his angels, wa rusulihi, wa kutubihi, wa rusulihi, his books and his messengers, wal yawmil akhir, and to believe in the last day. This is us. Those who believe in the unseen. ذلك الكتاب الف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. There is no doubt in it. هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. This book is a guidance to the muttaqeen. Who is the muttaqeen? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Believe in the unseen. And the unseen is the akhirat. And why is it so important? Why is it called a pillar of iman? Because of the benefits that it carries. It carries so very vital benefits that no mu'min will be able to survive in this dunya if it wasn't for the Akhirat. Wallahi, if it wasn't for the Akhirat. Why? I've got 7 points I want to share to you. Only 7 ones. We will just read them and translate them. The first wisdom or the first benefit of believing in the Akhirah is tuma'nina tu'nafs al-bashariya wa'rtiyahiha. Our souls would have been filled with agony and sorrow if it wasn't for the Akhirah. Those tyrants, that slaughter, that massacre, when will they come? When will we have a day? We, that had no say in this dunya, couldn't do anything but dua. Why do we do dua? Because there is a day to come when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reckon with those slaves that were disobedient. So it gives us that irtiyah, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see to them. We don't need to think of ways how to destroy them. We'll leave it up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because his punishment is many more times worse than the punishment we could ever give them. So we leave it for them. We leave it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we automatically, we've got that sakina in our ruh, the tranquility in our ruh. We're not filled with agony and sorrow. We feel pain for things that happen, yes. But we don't lose ourselves. We don't lose ourselves because they will come a day. Secondly, tarsikh aqidatu fi qalb al-mu'min. It strengthens the aqidah. And the aqidah is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's existence. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like that, unlike to his creation. All of these points of aqidah, this becomes affirmed and it becomes strengthened in the heart of a mu'min. Because of Yawmul Akhir. Yawmul Akhir. The third point is istizghar ad-dunya fi qalb al-mu'min. The dunya doesn't become the focal point of a mu'min. Because this dunya is temporary. This dunya has got everything. People who are secularists, this dunya has everything to win. They lose one portion of it, they get crazy. They lose it, they become stressed out. A mu'min is never stressed out. Because this dunya, in comparison to the akhirah, it's no comparison. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, I know the first and the last that will be taken out of Jahannam. As far as the last, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring him forth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him after he will be tired of the punishment in the Yawm Akhir. He will come out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell him, there is your reward. And then he will say, Ya Allah, but this is not my reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I said, there is your reward. It will go on thrice. And he won't believe Allah until the third time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there is your reward, into the Jannah. And the reward, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is tenfold the amount of the dunya. Tenfold the amount of the dunya. So we are relaxed people. The dunya, if we lose it, if it comes, we are on the same equilibrium. Our ruh doesn't excite itself over this dunya or fascinate itself over this dunya. We are stable people. Our aqidah is stable. And this is the benefit of Yawm al-Akhir, one of the benefits. One of the other ones is indifa'uhu ila al-a'mal al-salih. It encourages to do us good, to do good a'mal, to do good righteous deeds. And it encourages or it prevents us from doing, which is the fifth one, it prevents us from doing this, being disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because of the Jannah and the Nar. There's a reward for those who do good, and there's a punishment for those who do bad. And the punishment in the dunya in comparison to the akhirah, there is no equivalence. In a hadith sahih related by Imam Muslim radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring forth the person who had the worst life on this dunya of Ahlul Jannah, of the people of Jannah. People spoke against him, insulted him, he was poor, he was a sickly person. He had the worst life on this dunya, but he was from Ahlul Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring him forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, put your finger in the Jannah. And when he did that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, هَلْ رَأَيْتَ شَرًّا قَطْ? Have you seen anything bad before in your life? He said, لَا وَعِزَّتَكْ يَا رَبْ. I swear by your greatness I haven't seen anything, because the shidda in the enjoyment of the dunya is so severe that it made him forget everything. And the same with a person, Rasulullah said in the hadith, he continues, he say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring forward the person who had everything at his disposal, dunya, you name it. Pleasures was there, enjoyment was there, continuous, but he was of Ahl Nar, of the people of Yawm Akhir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring him forth and will tell him, put your finger into the Jahannam. And upon doing this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, have you seen any pleasures before? He says, La wa izzatak ya Rabbi, I haven't seen any enjoyment before. I haven't experienced any pleasure before in my life because of the severeness of the hellfire. So the difference in intensities is tremendous. Dunya, pleasures, in comparison to the akhirah, we can't almost call it a punishment, or we can't almost call it a thawab. No. So, that is the benefit of akhirah, believing in akhirah. You abstain yourself from the bad, and you embark upon that which is good. وَيُقَلِّلْ مِنَ الْجَرَائِمِ فِي الْمُجْتَمَعِ And it prevents chaos. Because if there was no akhirah, everybody would have done whatever. If there was no day of reckoning, a day when the reports were given out, and the results were given out, everybody would have just done what he would think is to his benefit. Whether it is evil or whether it is good. So there it prevents chaos. يُزِيلُ مِنَ النَّفْسِ الْيَأْسِ وَالْقُنُودِ It prevents from the self the despair and the sorrow. Despair and sorrow, it prevents the nafs from falling into the pit or the well of sorrow and despair. This is the akhirah. يَجْعَلِ الْإِنسَانِ صَابِرًا وَقَوِيًا فِي مُجَاهَةِ الشَّدَائِدِ Lastly, it makes a person strong. When it comes to trials and tribulations, it doesn't break up in tears. I can't do anything. There's always a way out. There's always a way out. This is what the belief in the akhirah does to a person. Seventh one, Ibrahim ibn Adham, he says, you say death is true, yet you have not prepared for it. You say death is true, yet you have not prepared for it. Perhaps the words of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, Kun fi dunya ka annaka gharibun aw abrin sabil. Don't take this dunya as your final abode. Don't settle down in this dunya. This dunya is but only a pastime. You are passing through like a traveler who travels. He overnights at the motel, sometimes in the hotel, at the house of a friend. It's a family member. He knows when he settles down there, it's not going to be for long. He's going to continue to his destination. Us mu'mineen have the same concept. Our destination is akhirat. And we are only here for a very short time. Ulama say, if you really want to know how short the time is, draw a line and take a knife and pull through the line. And that little portion that has been deleted with your knife, the blade of your knife, and this is life on earth. It's a wink of an eye. It goes over very quick. It goes over very quick. And upon this, Abdullah ibn Umar, because he relates this hadith, he says, إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظْرِ الصَّبَاحِ If you go to bed, don't wait until the morning comes to act, but utilize the time at night as well. It's a time of barakah. He says, إِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظْرِ الْمَسَاءِ And if you wake up the morning, don't wait for the night to do good deeds. Utilize the time wherever you find yourself. Make use of your time. وَخُذْ مِنْ صِحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ And take from your health to your marad. Because you're not forever going to be in this healthy state. But there will come a time when you're going to be ill. And this is something a woman should always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for afia. Siha wal afia. For well-being, physical well-being. Because a person that's ill can't do the amount of good works like a person that is not ill. Have you seen an ill person going to Jumu'ah? No. Have you seen an ill person going to Salatul Jama'ah? No. Have you seen an ill person work and earn money and give zakah? No. What can an ill person do? Little. In comparison to a person that is healthy. So we need to utilize our health at this moment. And then lastly it says, وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. And from your life to your death. Utilize your life. It's very short. And life doesn't ask for time. قَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ. Some of the awliya in the Salaf al-Salihin, they used to say, مَنْ أَكْثَرَ ذِكْرَ الْمَوْتِ. Whosoever increases the reminding himself of death, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless him with three karamat. With three karamat. The first one, they say, ta'ajil tawbah. You will continuous ask tawbah, seek tawbah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pardon. Pardon me, Ya Allah. Pardon me, Ya Allah. Because he knows death can come at any time. And this is the nasiha of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Akthiru min dhikri hadhim al-ladhat." Remind yourself as much as possible of the destroyer of pleasures. Because thinking of death, thinking of your state, your physical state down there, the flesh rotting, it's you alone with munkar and nakir. And if it is not, if it is up to your amal, it's up to your works and your deeds, it will determine your state down there. So the person is continuously asking for tawbah. This is one of the karama. The person who continuously reminds himself about death. وَالنَّشَاتْ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ. And he become nashid, active in ibadah. Ibadah is no problem for him. In the middle of the night, he jumps up. He does his tahajjud. He makes time for duha. He makes time for awabin. He makes time to make his salah in the masajid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all of those good amal. He says, the third one is qana'atul qalb. The heart is satisfied with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him. Why? Because I'm not gonna, this is not gonna last forever and forever. It's only temporal. He says, the awliya or the salafus salihin, they used to say, and a person who forgets about death, does not remind himself constantly about death, he will have thalata uqubat, he will have three punishments. The first one is taswifi tawbah, ay ta'akhiruha. He will delay his tawbah. He will always delay his tawbah. He does a mistake now. Should I just shift them away from one another?
Keep them off. No.
Tayyib. Taswifi tawbah. This is one thing that he will fall into. He will delay his tawbah. It's not immediate tawbah. The person is not constantly reminding himself of death, he will delay his tawbah. Oh, tomorrow. Tomorrow I'll make tawbah. Wait till the night. The night comes, he forgets. Insan continuously forgets. وَتَرْكُ الرِّضَى بِالْكَفَافِ. And he won't be satisfied with what he has. Because he thinks, I'm staying here in this dunya. I'm not passing on. He lives like a person that is not going to die because there's no reminder of death constantly. So he's not satisfied with what he has. I'm satisfied with what I have and that's it. Khalas. This is only trivial things. I'm not going to take it with me to the qabr. وَمَا يَكُونُ بِقَدْرِ الْحَاجَةِ وَالتَّكَاسُلِ عَنِ الْعِبَادَةِ. And he won't feel that activeness in him to carry on doing ibadah perpetually day after day. Because of this weakness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us over dhakirin al-maut kathira. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was one of those people that reminded himself of death. You know the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a ring. On his ring was written, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Many sahabas had rings. Had rings. And as a matter of fact, no gold rings is allowed. No gold rings is allowed for mu'mins, for men. No gold ring. Only silver. As far as the madhab of Imam al-Shafi, I don't know as far as the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa, perhaps the ulama can help me out there. Not only silver bracelets and silver necklaces is allowed for men. Even though it's silver, only one silver ring is allowed. Only one silver ring is allowed. For males. Silver watches, if it's pure silver, we're talking about pure silver. Pure gold. And read the books of fiqh, perhaps in the madhab of Abu Hanifa, I'm sure that there is complete illustration of what is pure gold and so on. In the madhab of Imam Shafi, pure gold is, if your grass is made up of pure gold, either way, if it's made up of if it's gold plated, how do I know it is haram if I keep it to a blowtorch and the gold flows from it? When it flows from it, I know that the gold upon it is a lot, and that is automatically haram. But gold in itself, if it's thin, it evaporates in the air. It evaporates. Those who are jewelers, speak to chachas, perhaps they can explain to you. It evaporates if it is melted. And if it's very thin, Wallahu ta'ala alam. So in the Shafi'i madhab, only a silver ring is allowed. Sayyidina Umar had a ring. And some other Sahabas had rings as well. And the beautiful sayings are reminders on the rings. The reminder of Sayyidina Umar was, Kafa bil mawti dhikran ya Umar. Ya Umar, he says, he speaks to himself, Ya Umar, the death is enough for you as a reminder, Ya Umar. So he used to look at it every time. He used to look at it and he's being reminded about death. This is how the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim embodied the nasiha of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Akthiru min dhikri hadhi min laddad. Number 8, you busy yourself with finding faults in others, yet you do not look at your own faults. And this is a common character in human. Yet it is so bad because it will retaliate upon us. The day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Sayyidina Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, and he's got a few verses of poetry, beautiful verses of poetry. He says, this is the norm of man. He says, in this verses, he says, عَجِبْتُ لِمَنْ يَبْكِي عَلَىٰ عَيُوبِ غَيْرِهِ. I find it very astonishing about a person crying and feeling sad over the ayub, the faults of others. وَلَمْ يَبْكِي عَلَىٰ عُيُوبِهِ دَمًا وَأَعْجَبُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ يَرَىٰ عَيْبَ غَيْرِهِ كَبِيرًا وَفِي عَيْنَيْهِ عَنْ عُيُوبِهِ عَمًا. What does it mean? He says, عَجِبْتُ لِمَنْ يَبْكِي عَلَىٰ عُيُوبِ غَيْرِهِ. I find it astonishing seeing people crying over other people's faults, and they don't cry blood over their own faults. They don't cry blood over their own faults. وَأَعْجَبُ مِنْ هَذَا, and more astonishing than this is, يَرَى عَيْبَ غَيْرِهِ كَبِيرًا, he sees that the عَيْب, the faults of his brother, is bigger than he is. وَفِي عَيُوبِهِ وَفِي عَيْنَيْهِ عَنْ عَيُوبِهِ عَمًا, and in his own eyes, he's completely blinded from his own faults. The ulama says, before you take out the splinter or a little stick out of the eye of your brother, take the tree trunk out of your eye. Because this is, before you think of somebody else's faults, think about your own faults before you do so. Don't speak bad about your brother, because this will prevent your answer, the answering from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will delay it. It will delay it upon us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. Don't make ghibah, speak bad or backbite your fellow brother. Would you like to eat his dead meat, his dead flesh? And Sayyidina Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Sayyidina Aisha ended upon him, and Sayyidina Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has just came from Safiya, his other wife, Ummul Mu'mineen. So she made a statement which Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam detested to a very, very high degree. And he said, Ya Aisha, if that word that you have just said now, if it had to be mixed with a luj, with the ocean, لَمَزَجَتْهُ, then it would have changed the taste of the ocean.
Subhanallah.
This is how great it is when a person makes statements of other brother, of your brother, which is not that, even if it's true. Because the Sahaba asked Ya Rasulullah, and when it's true, when you say the truth about them behind the backs, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا قُلْتَ الْحَقَّ فَقَدْ إِغْتَبْتَهُ. If you say the haq, you have made ghiba upon him. And if you have not said the truth, فَقَدْ بَهَدْتَهُ, and then you have caused upon yourself buhtan. And buhtan is the very, very highest form of lies that a person can tell. So even if a person said the truth, it's still considered a ghiba. And if it's a lie, it's even greater than that. Hassan al-Basri once was told, you know, Fulan, such and such, such a person, spoke bad about you, he said this and that about you. What did he do? He took a bowl of fruit, the best fruit you can find in the souk, he filled it in there and he went to the person's door. He knocked on the door and he gave it to the person and said, Jazakallahu khairan. The person got a shock of his lifetime. He said, what is this? He said, you have given me of your good deeds. Didn't he hear the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, Man al-Muflis, who is the one who is bankrupt? The Sahaba said, the one who doesn't have any dinars and doesn't have any dirhams. They thought it's money related, but Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no. The person who harmed his brother by speaking badly about him in all sorts of ways. The day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the haq will be returned. And when he doesn't have any more good deeds, the bad deeds of the person he harmed will be transferred to his plate. And that is the person that's bankrupt. The day when everybody will seek for good deeds and for shafa'at. So, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, radiallahu ta'ala, and one of the tabi'een, the generations after the tabi'een, he said, if you really want to make ghiba against your mother and your father, because they are more deserving of your good amal than anybody else. The ghiba of your mother and father. He was just explaining the fact that the amal, that the deeds will be transferred over. Will be transferred over. Ninth advice of Ibrahim ibn Adam, he says, you eat that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided to you, yet you do not thank Him. And this is one of the major things why the answer is delayed upon this ummah. We don't thank, we're not people of gratitude anymore. And what is thanks? Because we need to realize the understanding of thanks. What is thanks? Ibn Ata'illah al-Sakandari, one of the Sufis in northern Africa, he says, "Man lam yashkur al-ni'ama faqad ta'arrada li zawalihi wa man shakara faqad qayyadaha bi iqaliha." A person who thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shows gratitude towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has tied the ni'mas which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. And the one who does the shows gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has made himself prone to losing that ni'mah. If I've got a car, or if I've got money, the money is spent in haram, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't put any blessing in the money will, as it came in, if it was very quickly, it will leave the same way. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you were truly grateful for what I give you, I will increase you in bounties. وَفِي الْإِصْطِلَاحِ. So what is shukr? What is shukr according to the sharia? According to our ulama of aqidah and sharia, they say, الشكر صرف العبد صرف العبد جميع ما أنعم الله به عليه فيما خلق لأجله. Is to engage all of those bounties which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon you into that which it was created for. My eyes, was it created to look at haram? My tongue, was it created to speak bad of my brother? No, Allah gave you a tongue as a ni'mah to utilize it for good, for your own sake. My money, is it there to be utilized on only dunya and not think of, let me utilize it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me do some sadaqah to jariya. Perhaps I will benefit. Of course you will benefit if you do some sadaqah to jariya. Keep it for a talib ilm, send him away. Whether it's Pakistan, whether it's India, whether it is the Middle East, send them away. Let them become scholars, that they bring back what is termed traditional Islam. This is what we should think of about this ni'am, our yawf. Are we utilizing it the proper way? Fi sabilillah, or are we just spending it in leisures and pleasures? Sayyidina Junaid al-Baghdadi, everybody knows him. Junaid al-Baghdadi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa qaddasallahu sirrah. He was asked, Ya ghulam, ma shukr? He was asked, what is shukr? And he answered, he was only 7 years old at the time, Imam al-Junaid. We know, of course, he was reared by his uncle, Sri al-Saqati, who was a great, great Sufi and a great pious man in his time. His answer was, فَقَالَ أَلَّا يُعْصَى اللَّهَ بِنِعَمٍ, not to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his bounties. At 7 years old, he realized this concept already. So it's something we need to instill in our children, everybody. Inshallah, lastly, we will end off with the last advice. The last advice of Ibrahim ibn Adham radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says, you bury your dead, yet you do not take a lesson from it. You bury your dead, but you don't take a lesson from it. What does this mean? What does this mean? It means that when we look at our dead being buried at that moment, I don't know if you've got the opportunity in the UK to see this much, but alhamdulillah, in some other places in South Africa, everybody gave us around the maqbara. You see there, there's the kafan, goes down in the dusty sand. And many people at that moment are so under a state of waswas, shaitan has completely made them forget about the most apparent thing that appears from the burial. And what is it? The most apparent thing is that nothing goes in that burial except that corpse. No money, no house, no friends, no bank balance, no whatever thing to protect him. Nothing goes down in there. A naked corpse covered in lafa'if. In lafa'if. This is what many of us forget when we stand there seeing the corpse coming down there. And the ayah explains, Yawman, Yawma la yanfa'u malu wa la banun illa man atallaha biqalbin salim. The day when everybody will be resurrected, a day where no money, where no banun, where no children will help you, except man atallaha biqalbin salim. Except the one who has came to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a pure state, a pure heart, and a true Islamic identity. This is what we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, to prevail a state in us, in our hearts, and to make us as a people that will uphold the Islamic identity in our lives, in our actions, in our mu'amalat, in our doings with other people. This is very important for us, because the result is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat us like mu'mineen the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. Upon this, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa wa razuqna al-tiba'a. O Allah, show us the haqq, the true as true. Not only that, O Allah, wa razuqna al-tiba'a, but grant us to follow the truth. Allahumma arina al-batila batila wa razuqna al-tiba'a. O Allah, don't show us the batil as batil, but also help us to abstain from the batil. And lastly, I would really thank everybody. MashaAllah, it's been a blessed gathering. Alhamdulillah, I see lots of young faces here, young blood. And I can see that there is a response to the call of the coordinators and the imams and the people that did the effort to stir up or to organize something as beautiful as this gathering. And it brings joy to a person's heart to see that alhamdulillah there is iman, and not only some but a lot of iman still flowing down there in the bloodstream of the mu'mineen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase this and to make this strong and to make this firm in this ummah here in Kithri and the ummah all over the world, so that we can be again the pioneers of this world, because it's only Islam that will bring peace and nothing else. Only Islam. And inshallah ta'ala, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all our efforts, and if I've said anything to offend anybody or if I've said anything wrong, forgive me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone gives tawfiq. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
If you'd like to ask Sheikh Saad any questions, if you'd like to down a brief question, then inshallah, if there's enough opportunities, then your answer should be achieved. We'll have half an hour of question and answer. First question, we all come from Adam alayhi salam. How did our color or race change? This is the question, first question somebody asked. We all come from Adam alayhi salam. How did our color or race change?
Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, wherever a person dies, he has been created from the earth where he dies. So if you die in the earth that is different from the earth in which your brother perhaps in Palestine dies, this is what you were created from. When you die, this is the earth from which you were created. Allah Ta'ala.
Question, how can we increase our love for the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam?
To make lots of salat on the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. To make lots of salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it might not sound realistic, but this is how dhikr works. Dhikr is the essence of all good. When a person keeps on with the salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is better. You know, or a person makes salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a qalb ghafil, with a absent-hearted, but to make salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is better than a person It does not make Salat on the Prophet is absent-hearted. And from that state, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you from state to state to state to state until you become the true lover of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
We have a question, where does Sheikh Saab teach and what does he teach?
No, this is a good one. I teach in Abu Zahra. I teach Arabic for beginners and intermediate twice a week, Wednesdays and Thursdays. Mondays, I've got a 2-hour session in Arabic for beginners in Bradford Victor Street Masjid. Fridays after, this is also after Isha from 7:30 to 9:30. Now Isha will be late, it will start a little bit later, perhaps I think 8 o'clock. Allahu ta'ala alam. We do Aqeedah and Hadith on Friday nights. Aqeedah and Hadith. And Saturday nights we do from 8 till 9, we do Tafsir of the Holy Quran. At Abu Zahra, premises in Keithley. So we've got 3 hours, 3 sessions during the week at Abu Zahra and TRZ on Highfield Lane, and 2 sessions in Bradford for adults. And of course during the day we've got Hifz al-Quran for the young ones, 2 hours from 4 to 6 or from 4:30 to 6:30 at Abu Zahra Institution. And this is basically what keeps us busy. Alhamdulillah.
We have a question. What is the ruling regarding asking for intercession from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What is the ruling regarding asking for intercession?
There's absolutely the ruling there is it's halal. It is actually recommended.
Why do we need madhabs and when we have Quran and Sunnah?
This particular question takes long to answer. If a person reads usul al-fiqh, which inshallah I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the questioner read something in usul al-fiqh, he will come to realize that it's not an easy thing to follow the Quran and Sunnah alone. It's not an easy thing. Let me give you a simple example. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the mutallaqa, the woman that is divorced, who has a menstrual period, who is not hamil, she is not pregnant, she is not a Aisha, she is not in a menopause. In other words, this woman, she has to keep, she has to stay in Anka for 3 quru. A quru, for 3 quru's. What's a quru? The Hanafis and the Shafis are different, both of them have very strong dalil. Very strong dalil. The Shafi says she has to stay in Aida for 3 tumors, for 3 clean periods. The Hanafi say for 3 menstrual periods. Why do they differ? Why do they differ? If the questioner can come up with the reason why they differ, then you will realize as well that it is not easy just to follow the Quran and Sunnah. Because you don't know which one of the two is correct. Both of them is substantiated not only by Quran and Sunnah but also by Lugha, by the Arabic language. And this is only one part. One small minute differences, the Lugha differences between the ulama. The Lugha differences between the ulama. This is why we find differences. So a person who goes on his own steam and thinks he will find the haqq browsing through the hadith in the Quran ayats, it's very, very likely that he will get to the right position in matters of ikhtilaf. In matters of ikhtilaf, no.
We have a question. What are your views on eating in places that sell or allow alcohol consumption?
As far as eating in places, restaurants, I'm against it. I say it is not prohibited. As far as shopping at Morrison's and those places, as long as you don't buy the alcohol, it's okay. Allahu ta'ala. As long as you don't buy the alcohol, it's okay. especially in the West.
We have a question. What is the difference between Wahhabis and Sunnis?
Wahhabis and Sunnis. We are Wahhabis, all of us are Wahhabis. What do I mean by it? We are all Wahhabis is that we are all slaves of the Wahhab, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we call Wahhabis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does Wahhab mean? Wahhab means the bestower, the bestower, the giver. All of us are Wahhabis. So if you want to call me Wahhabi, my phone Wahhabi, I'll just look at a different light. Some people, well, understood it differently today. And those people that call themselves Wahhabis, people that follow the Quran and the Sunnah, and the people that Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are people that follow us as far as the Aqidah is concerned. They follow the Madhab of the Maturidi and the Ash'ari. As far as the fiqh is concerned, they follow one of the four madhabs, and somebody has to come with a very, very strong dalil to say that those madhabs in aqidah and those madhabs in fiqh is not sunnah in Quran. They have to come with extremely strong dalil to prove that that is not Quran and sunnah. And what he is on is Quran and sunnah.
Question: in the Quran, it says that anything harmful to anybody is haram. So is smoking haram?
Of course it is haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram for the tayyibat wa harrama alaykum al-khaba'ith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram upon the khaba'ith, the things that is harmful upon you. And today it has been established that smoking is haram. Allah ta'ala.
In the nutshell, how can we protect our family and ourselves, as the Quran states, to protect oneself and one's family from the fire, in this particularly in this Western culture?
Perhaps the best way to protect your children is to get them a good education from very young. When I talk about good education, it is Islamic education, not a secular education, an Islamic education. And to constantly keep them in good company. And most of all is the mother and the father, when they are preserving their Islamic identity to the fullest, the children will always be following their parents. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadith, كل مولود يولد على فطرة. Each مولود is born on the natural deen or the natural faith of Islam. على فطرة. إنما أبويه يهودانه أو يمجسانه أو ينصرانه. However it is his father or the parents that makes him a Yahudi, a Nasrani, or a Majusi, a fire worshipper. So it depends on the parents to mold the child at the young age. And this is the age which is where the parent bears the full responsibility. Only until the child becomes puberty, the child bears its own. But doesn't mean that we can leave the child around, come to the world now. We still need to guide him. We still need to guide him. But they bear us of their own actions.
There's a question: do we celebrate our Prophet's birthday?
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is celebrated by all ulama of traditional background. It's celebrated by all ulama of traditional background. The only problem that we have is if people say it's farad, if you do it, you've done a farad. If you don't do it, you've done a grievous sin. This is a bid'ah. But if you do it with the niyyah that it is a good bid'ah, then it should be celebrated. Sayyidina Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was born, it is Abu Lahab, his uncle, who insulted him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Abu Lahab heard of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who came to give him the news? A jariya, a slave girl. He became so happy. Abu Lahab, yani, who is in the Hellfire, he became so happy that he said, "You free, you free." He became so happy, he celebrated the occasion, he said, "You free." It was Allah, you free. There is a hadith in Sahih Muslim, in Sahih al-Bukhari, Afwan. And for that reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Abu Lahab a lesser punishment than the other mushrikeen in Jahannam just because of that action. So, if we love Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we want to expose our love physically, why not? Why not?
We have a question. What is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam created from?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala it's a common question. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was created from flesh and bone. But what? How do we understand this flesh and bone? We understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has understood it. Jalla Jalaluhu, who is his creator, alayhi salatu wa salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed him in the Quran as Nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed him in the Quran as Nur. This is how, this is my understanding of that flesh and bone of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has addressed him in the Quran. Allah ta'ala a'lam.
We have a question, in what way should we celebrate our Prophet's birthday? What's allowed and what's not, i.e. a party?
Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's birthday can be celebrated in any way, as long as it's not muharramat. As long as it's not muharramat. The instruments, and as far as the instruments is concerned, it's also a topic of ikhtilaf. And certain nasheeds, and nasheeds of course with a human voice, just with a human voice, these are all allowed. These are all allowed. Singing praise upon the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam based on the hadith in Bukhari, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu came into the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there was two young girls, Jariyatan, Yaghniyanu bihima'i ba'uth. They used to sing, what type of songs? War songs. When the Muslim women go out, they sing war songs. And when the Mushrikeen used to do their battles, they used to sing war songs. Not any songs that would set up any shahawat, lalvat, will awaken the cardinal desires within a person, not this type of music. But music that will inspire a person to do good. So he came in and he said, "Ya Aisha, mizmaru shaytan inda Rasulullah." And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in the day, it was the day of Eid, the day of Eid al-Adha. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was laying and relaxing. And he said, "Abu Bakr, stop." This is, and he indicated it is allowed in the hadith. But the ulama from all the hadith that he speaks about music, the hadith of the Sudanians that came, or the Abyssinians that came in, they came to the masjid of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kana yal'abuna wa yal'abuna, they used to sing, they used to play, and they used to sing, bidaraki wal hirab, with the swords and the shields in the masjid, and they used to do a dancing and singing. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to look, as a hadith in Sahih Bukhari, used to look out by his door because he was in the house of the Hujra of Sayyidina Aisha, which is attached to the masjid. He used to look out and see them doing it in the masjid. And Sayyidina Aisha said, I want to see what they're doing. And she creeped up behind the shoulder and looked over and she saw it and she relates the hadith. And this is also Sahih Bukhari. All of these are hadith gathered. The ulama say, as long as the types of music that we sing, the person who sings it is a male, or if it's a female, the female should be younger than or under the age of puberty. The moment she's puberty, it becomes haram. This is the female. The male, mutlaqan, all the way is allowed to sing. Second point, instruments. If it bears the instruments which is allowed, the buff in Sawala Masai, it's only allowed in wedding Sawala Masai, no, it's allowed all over in decals and whatever, then it's okay. Other instruments, it won't be okay. The last point is the wording of the nasheed. If the wording of the nasheed is nothing that will stir up the desires in a person, evil desires, and so on, or the wording carries haram, then it is not allowed. If it doesn't carry that, it is permissible. But a person should be very wary with music today and be very open-minded. I will see the acts in the shops, Islamic shops are filled with machines and there is instruments in it. And it's either we accept this or we reject it and let our children seek other means of entertainment, which is completely haram, even satanic to a degree. You know? So if we say one day is haram because of a few instruments, then we need to find a substitute for that. If we can't, and then we're going to put them in a difficult situation. Sun, which is the sheep that's now Sun Yusuf, and all of these, there's Rehan from Malaysia. All of them, they use instruments, but they get the message across. If our children are left with something which is not temptatious to the ear, and they might go on to something else, then I will say this is okay. We will take أَخَفُ الضَّرَرَيْنِ, the lesser of the two evils. We will let them continue with this, instead of letting them continue with evil like my conjecture in Kylie Romero, you hear that the youngster speaking about la hawla wa la quwwata. There is no, absolutely no example set in the characters or the singers of these songs, let alone what they sing. So it is a ikhtilafi matter, and to be moderate in it for the sake of the ummah, because if it tied the top of the bottle or the cap of the bottle too tight, it will not spoil the thread, and you don't want that to happen. Then it can't be tied anymore. We can't tie the top of the bottle anymore. And Allah Ta'ala, I think that is a moderate approach. Allah Ta'ala.
I have a question. I know a guy who does not believe in the hadith, but only follows the Quran as he says hadith is man-made. What arguments can I put forward to him?
Put forward to him the Quran? The Quran says, وَمَنْ يُتَعِ اللَّهَ فَقَدْ وَمَنْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ. If you say you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of course the word of the Quran, the word of Allah which is the Quran, فَاتَّبِعُونِ, then follow me. يُحَبِّبُكُمْ اللَّهُ, then Allah loves you. And there's various ayat in the Quran, there's numerous ayat indicating that whoever claims that the Quran is the only scripture to be followed is lost. Is lost, undoubtedly.
There is a question. Please, could you explain today that Qaidianis are not Muslims, and their books are posted in Hindu library as well as they have a television station, and that there is a request made that it's told to everybody that not to follow these ideas or not to read their books. Qaidiani.
Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. Mirza Ghulam Ahmad claimed to be a prophet, the last prophet. And when somebody does this, according to our aqidah, he is out of the fold of Islam. Most of what he wrote was written in the toilet, and nothing in comparison to what was said upon the other prophets. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. Sayyidina Musa spoke directly to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Isa got his revelation in a very sublime fashion, very beautiful way. Sayyidina Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had wahi through Jibreel. Sometimes he used to get it in the form of browsers, sometimes he used to get it in various forms. Here we find a person calling himself a prophet, and most of his revelations, so-called revelation, has been revealed to him in the toilets. So it doesn't make sense to me that he is a prophet. And anything of Ahmadiyyism, whatever you call it, is a false concept.
We have an announcement to make. There's a car, Elraj Cavalier, parked behind the mosque. A car needs to come in there. So whoever's car is the red Elraj Cavalier, can you please move it? There is a question, similar question, and this is, how do we stop Qaidianis? What can we contribute to stopping the Qaidianis?
The only thing you can contribute to stop Qaidianism is not to convert them, but to stay on your aqidah and be a Muslim. Expose your identity. Expose your identity. Because your embodiment of Islam and your embodiment of the aqidah, this is what rubs off on everybody. What rubs off on everybody. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of the day, is the one that carries over your state to other people. It's no use, you're going to end up in arguments which will in turn cause you to end up in mira. In mira is argumentation which is haram. Stick to your own aqidah and be a Muslim. Stick to your own aqidah and practice to your best ability to be a good Muslim. This is the only way Islam was spread. One of the ways that Islam was spread to the Far East, to Malaysia, Indonesia, India, and so forth. These people had a state upon them, and they dealt with people that were worse than Qadianis, Hindus, and all of these Hindus became Muslim. See Indonesia and Malaysia and in India, if you can find a stronghold, especially Malaysia and in Indonesia, if you can find a stronghold of Hinduism, no. And these people were before, they were another deen. But the states of the people who took Islam, they changed the mechanism of the people there.
We have a question. What are the blessings of keeping a beard at an early age?
The blessings?
What are the blessings of keeping a beard at an early age?
There's a great thawab not to shave your beard once it shows. There's a thawab, sunnah. It's sunnah, and according to the majority of the ulama, of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, it is haram to shave your beard. Shave it to the skin. But to shorten your beard, there's a difference of opinion in there. The opinion in the Shafi Madhab, it's okay to shorten your beard. To shorten your beard even less than a fist length. Even less than a fist length. To keep your beard is wajib. To shorten it is mubah, but to shave it is haram. To shave it is completely haram to the skin. And this is haram.
We have a question. What are your views on how the media portrays Islam, especially after the recent events?
And of course, we should be wise enough not to take whatever the media says. Quran says, وَإِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. If a fasiq, what is a fasiq? A person that either perpetuates on doing a enormity, or he is continuously doing sagair and never makes tawbah from the sagair, and this is him. This is a fasiq. If the fasiq comes to you with some information, fatabayyan, and then clarify and find out whether it's true or not. Don't just settle for whatever he tells you.
We have a question.
This is the nasiha of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Inshallah, there's only four questions remaining. What do you think of the banning of the hijab in France and the fact that some sheikhs went along with it and said you have to follow that ruling?
I heard from my sheikhs that this is a wrong fatwa and we are not in favor of that fatwa of the sheikh or the school or whatever who gave that fatwa. That the banning of the hijab is okay because the people are in a country where they are ruled by non-Muslim leaders and they have to obey the leaders where they are. This is our opinion that the ulama, I heard from them that it is not acceptable in this fatwa.
I heard making dua in congregation is bidah, innovation. What is your view?
I haven't thought of it.
What happens if you touch a dog?
What happens if you touch a dog? If you touch a dog, this is a fiqhi mas'ala. It's a fiqhi mas'ala. Your wudu is not broken. Your wudu is not invalidated. If you touch a dog, your wudu is not invalidated. According to the mother of Imam Shafi, because I'm Shafi, and for the Hanafis, you should see a Hanafi Shaykh if you're Hanafi. The Shafis, if you touch a dog and the skin is dry, and the surface of the dog is dry as well, you did not, najasa was not transferred. Najasa was not transferred. However, if the dog, wherever you're touching, the Shafi mother, the whole dog, he is everything, paws, you name it, everything. Not only the tongue and the nostrils is najasa, but the whole dog. If you touch his hair and your hand is wet, najasa is transferred. Your hand is dry and the dog is wet, najasa is transferred. You have to wash your hand or your clothes 7 times with water and one of it with clay. This is the mother of Imam Shafi, to get rid of it. So, anyway, when you wash the clothes, it doesn't mean that you have to get clay wherever and rub it into the clothes. No, the ulama say 7 washes with clean pure water, and preferably the washing with the clay water should be right in the beginning, so that the other clean washes can clean away the clay from the garment. The way you wash it is by having a bucket. And the clay has been dissolved in the bucket, so the water becomes dusky to a certain degree. And this is what we call about washing it in the clay once over 7.
Can you share some more information on the 2 parts of jihad, e.g., the inner one and the external one?
Some ulama has claimed that there's 2 types of jihad, and of course this is a well-established opinion amongst the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that there is jihad in nafs and jihad bin nafs. The ulama say the jihad in nafs is the more superior way form of jihad from a perspective. And some ulama say that the jihad bin nafs is more superior from another perspective. As far as the jihad, jihad bin nafs is concerned, or jihad fi nafs is concerned, or jihad in nafs to suppress the self in his desires. This is the type of jihad. The ulama says it's superior because when a person fights on the battlefield, when he fights his enemy, and he gets slain, he becomes a martyr in the process, his reward is Jannah. So a great reward he will get in Jannah that he will tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send me down to the earth so that I can become another martyr again, or a martyr again. So his reward is great. If he wins the battle between him and his enemy, then he will get the reward of being a mujahid, and he will get the reward of the booty. However, if the jihad of nafs against yourself is lost from your side, where will you be? In Jahannam. The person who loses the battle against himself, he is in despair the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. So from this aspect, It's a more serious battle to fight, and it's a battle you fight not only once a year, according to it's once a year to follow to make jihad. It is more superior because you do this jihad almost every day of your life. Every day of your life. So it's a very important concept that the person has to sort of, accept in his life to do this jihad continuous. As far as from the other aspect, someone might say that jihad bin nafs with your soul to give it off, peace of Allah, is more superior. Because of the hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Barawat as-sinan jihad fi sabilillah." That the barwa to sinan, if you take a pyramid, you take the last part of the pyramid, the last triangle, this is the barwa to sinan. This is what jihad forms, it's the highest part of Islam. So now we're trying to say, what is jihad? Jihad doesn't only take the form of giving the life fi sabilillah. Because Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in hadith, "Jahid al-kufara bi amwalikum wa al-sinatikum wa anfusikum." Fight non-belief with your money, with your tongue, or with your pens, or with your souls. So it takes various types depending on which situation you are in. In our situation, undoubtedly the scholars have said that it doesn't take the form of taking the sword and chasing down upon whoever you think is an unbeliever. It doesn't look like that. There's agreement according to the rightly guided scholars in our time that this is not the way we should do it. Allah Ta'ala.
We have a last question. Where did the Naqshbandi Tariqa come from?
I don't know. Shah Naqshband is the person who the Tariqa Naqshbandi, Tariqa Naqshbandi Tariqa is referred to Shah Naqshband, like the Tariqa Ash-Shadiliya is referred, was named after the Shaykh Abu Hassan Ash-Shadili. This is where Ash-Shadiliya Tariqa comes from. And so the Naqshbandi it goes back to the name of the Sufi Shah Naqshband, and this is what we know.
I just like to say after you have eaten, inshallah, then after Asr there'll be food served, and after that we'll be collecting some money if you can donate for, because we're opening the class from this Tuesday evening on Hanif Ifiq, following Muhtasar al Quduri's book on English translation, which will be given free to everyone who attends. And so we ask your financial support in any way. It will be collected from you, inshallah, after the food is served. Now, Hadith Sahib will speak now, and he will present some prizes for some students who have won some prizes.
Mashallah. Inna alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi Muhammad wa alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah. Al-yawm yawm yawm lana. لأننا نجد فينا العلماء شيخ سعد العطاس دام بركاته وبحثنا في الإسلام نحن ندعو له اللهم بارك له في حياته وعلمه ونفعنا بعلومه وفي يده آمين. Well respected brothers and guests, firstly, I would like to take the opportunity to thank our honored guest and for the another guest, Ibrahim Sir, Imam of the Ghousiya Mosque, our chief guest, thank for his speech delivered to us. Also a big thank to all the youngsters who took part in organizing the event. Remember, listening to our guest speech is not the end of it all. It is now up to us to follow this and make sure our Muslim brothers are also guided to follow this. You will be happy to know that since last December, a group of young students within our society nominated to set up an Islamic study class. This takes place weekly every Tuesday after Isha. We have now completed the 14 hadiths. Allah Ra'im, Imam Nabi Nawawi, Rahimahullah wa ta'ala, and the Tajweed al-Quran, written by Hazrat Mawlana Imam Uddin Chowdhury, Tulkani Dhanat Tawakar. Inshallah, from this week, we have planned to commence Al-Muhtasar al-Quduri, the famous Hanafi fiqh. I would like to invite everyone here to attend this class. On completion of the course, students will receive certificates, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, it has been a year since the Hibz al-Quran classes commenced in this mosque. And recently, we carried out a competition where all the students took part in a test, and three students here successfully completed and passed. They are Muhammad Abdul Khadir, Muhammad Mahir bin Mia, Muhammad Rasul Mia. I would like our honorable guests to present the awards to these students. Muhammad Abdul Khadir. Muhammad Mahir bin Mia. Muhammad Rasul Mia.
MashaAllah, MashaAllah. Barakallahu fiqh. A'alakum ala taqwa.
Alhamdulillah. Another little bit. Youngster society.
It's a very good idea.
Alhamdulillah. And on this note, I would like to finish by saying I would like everyone's dua, and I pray for all that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the tawfiq to carry out all dini and Islamic khidmat. Ameen, summa ameen, wa ahmad awana, alhamdulillah.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Al-Fatiha. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك جل وجهك عز جارك والله يفعل ما يشاء بقدرته ويحكم ما يريد بعزته يا حي يا قيوم يا بديع السماوات والأرض يا ذا الجلال والإكرام اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وذنوب والدينا ومشائخنا ولجميع المسلمين أجمعين ربنا يسر ولا تعسر ربنا تمن بالخير أنت يا الله الكريم الميسر اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا الحمد لله على كل حال ونعوذ بالله من حال أهل الضلال ورحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم إنا نسألك التوفيق والإخلاص ودوام النعم وحسن الختام اللهم باعد بيننا وبين خطايانا كما باعدت بين المشرق والمغرب اللهم نقنا من خطايانا كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس اللهم اغسل خطايانا بالماء الثلج والبرد اللهم لا تدع لنا في مقامنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا حاجة إلا قضيتها ويسرتها فيسر أمورنا واشرح صدورنا ونور قلوبنا واختم الصالحات أعمالنا اللهم توفنا مسلمين اللهم توفنا مسلمين اللهم توفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.